This show is brought to you by Databrill, the scalable Amazon PPC management for large Amazon sellers and brands. Visit sellersessions.com/agency for more details. Now, the other thing with the Chinese, they have a huge access to funds, don't they? In terms of venture capital, private funds, governments, there's just, it's insane. The money is everywhere in China, isn't it? In terms of putting into the business. Whereas in the UK, US, obviously we can get access to money, but the banks are useless for us. And we run a cash flow business. So you need cash to run on Amazon. And one of the biggest problems that people do on Amazon is that they can't expand their line because they run out of cash. Talk me through the advantages over in China.
Yeah, so this is a very crucial point. You know, in the online marketing today, speed is everything, but also how much money to lose you have. I'm not saying how much money to invest or to use. I'm saying how much money to lose you have, because the approach of Chinese sellers is it's really losing money for as much time as they can, because yeah. They can afford to beat their competition by investing a lot of money, by doing a lot of trials and errors, like we said before, get shit done. I mean, most of the time when you get your shit done, this shit is not working. So you have to invest a lot of money. You have to lose a lot of money because you don't know how to approach the market, but you want to do it now and here and now, you know, you want to have the results. So what happened is that there would be only for Chinese startups, something like 50 billion venture capital invested in 2018, and I'm talking about US dollar. And already like $1 trillion of US dollars has been invested over the past 10 years by the Chinese government and private investors. This number is huge. We in Europe, in the US, especially in Europe, we don't see those numbers. Some of my clients, some of my friends in Europe, they are sellers, and even the big sellers, they don't see those numbers. I mean, the big sellers, they have an advantage that they have all the funds of the company or the investors. But the average seller, the medium seller, how can they do in Europe if they don't have all of this money to invest and to spend, to make more mistakes that would actually give them the time and the knowledge to approach the market in the best way? So, for example, we took the example of JD.com, how they became so big. So from 2012 until 2016, they've been losing millions. I'm talking about hundreds of millions that they were going red, they were going negative. But from 2014 until 2017, they've been growing faster than Amazon and Alibaba. Why they've been growing so much? Because they didn't actually care of losing the money when they had such a big investment, because it was all part of a big project that didn't see, you know, negatively losing so much money. So what happens here with the Chinese Amazon sellers, I'm not saying that all of them have got billions to invest, but there is a lot of private investors, of equity funds, that are ready to give all the money that they have to sell on Amazon. Why? Because Amazon is the hottest platform right now.
Yeah.
So they know that if they invest in Amazon right now with somebody that knows how to do it, they might make money. And this somebody who knows how to do it, it might be, I'm not kidding, a kid 26 years old who just left the company. I mean, I don't want to say kid, I want to say, you know, a young man, because also we Europeans, we are young men when we start. But when a Chinese young man starts 26 years old, just after graduating and working for 2 years only in one company, they have such a background that is completely different. They have a approach, working method, and they have this huge funding coming from some investors. So the last thing I want to tell you, and this is also not written in the article, so I'm giving you some exclusive. Seriously, yesterday I had this talk with a friend of mine. He called me desperate on WeChat. He called me without even sending me a message. You know, somebody would maybe send you a message before calling, and I say, hey, what's up? What's going on? And you say, hey, I'm desperate. I don't know where to turn, who to ask information. I don't know who to ask you help to. I said, what happened? So this guy is sourcing product, and is also helping other Amazon sellers, and is also having his own Amazon account, is selling products that now I don't really remember what, but he told me, so David, it happened like this. We are sourcing this kind of product from this supplier, and it's a big supplier. It's just a factory. What happens is that last week we noticed on Amazon a new competitor there is cutting our throat. It's selling exactly the same product $2 cheaper.
Yeah.
I said, how is it possible? And he said, okay, so we did some research on this name. I don't remember the brand name right now. So they did some research, and this brand name was launched. They didn't have a website, or the website was not directly, sending them to any name that they knew. They did the research, and they found the Kickstarter campaign that was run, listened by who? By the owner of the factory that is sourcing their product. So what happens here? The Chinese sellers, in many cases, they have this availability of products, of funds, of everything, and they don't care to actually beat you in the same product line. They just don't care because they can do it, you know. So this is scary, actually, what's happening. And I told them, there is pretty much nothing that you can do just because he's your supplier. It's not correct. I mean, we Westerns, we wouldn't do that. They pretty much don't care. So, you know, you can't say nothing. I said, you can try to source your products from a different supplier, try to hit a different niche, try to beat them, you know, in your product quality, in your social media, in your content. Today, this is my advice. Do what Chinese people still cannot do. That is, tell a story about your product. This is the best way you can beat Chinese sellers.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. And it just goes back to that point with having deep pockets. This helps people to understand that when they go, they're looking, say, at the Chinese seller, and they go, how can they possibly sell at that price? They're obviously taking a hit and a loss. And the whole point is, if they've done all their background research, they're waiting for you to drop your pants and get out the market and, you know, maybe liquidate your stock and then literally grandfather themselves in. So they're willing to go deep and lose money over a period of time. Okay, so something I want to touch on, but not necessarily on in terms of techniques. People talk about black hat all the time, right? Mm-hmm. We've done shows on black hat techniques, which ones to avoid, etc. Not interested in talking about individual black hat techniques. It's well documented. What I'm interested in talking about is the tolerance for risk. Because I get the impression that, and not everyone in China does black hat. There is people that do use black hat. There are people that don't, right? Mm-hmm. But I think the ones that do, the tolerance for risk is a lot different. It's like they don't see it as black hat. Does that make sense? Like, I'd have lots of different conversations from all different types of people, different types of sellers. But one common thread I found is that the black hat thing isn't black hat to them. That's just part of doing business.
Yeah. So, you know, as we said before, in China, as you have this huge competition and you have so many people that are competing against you, sometimes you're rewarded just because you take the shortcut and, you know, you can get to the point much quicker, much faster than your competitors. Because you're taking the shortcut. So it's a different way of actually approaching the problem of tolerating the risk, as you were saying. Yeah. Because here, there's almost nothing wrong in copying each other or in breaking a little bit the rules. There are so many people that if somebody breaks the rules, nobody notices. But the thing is that actually when somebody starts breaking the rules and other people understand how to break the same rules, then we will get into a very bad loop where everybody's breaking the rules. So this is pretty much what is happening right now in China with the black hat. They don't see it as a risk just because everybody's doing that. The scary thing, just to let you understand the weight of this issue, is that there are special courses only for black hat practices.
Right.
And they are sold at a very high price. Like for a 2-day course, a medium seller would spend $2,000 to $4,000. Mm-hmm. These 2-day courses are very intensive. You know, there are those self-claimed gurus of Amazon sales that where they show all the black hat techniques and they just say, you're stupid if you don't do it because everybody's doing it. So, you know, this is the way that they actually do their marketing. There is a lot of techniques, a lot of tactics, but they pretty much don't care how to get the reward. They just want to have it. They just want to get there. And they want to do it as quick as they can, even by breaking the rules. Because The common approach of the Chinese sellers would be to make more than one account in Amazon. So you could be covered if something happens to your primary account. They would have like 6 to 7 different accounts, and they're really masters on taking the shortcut. The control behind the black hat is made by learning algorithm. It's machine learning algorithm. So this is tricky because even the algorithm of the product rank on Amazon is constantly changing. So this would take a lot of effort. So on one side, it is easy to practice the black hat, but on the other side, if you really want to do it good, you have to spend a lot of time, a lot of resources, and even people working for you doing the black hat. Regarding the risk tolerance, coming back, it's all a matter of culture. They pretty much don't see the risk just because they're not living in the United States or in Europe. So even if they got caught, there is much less to worry about that. In the worst case, they can just make a different company, start up a new Amazon store, launch a new brand. They don't care because anyway, they're not working for branding.
I want to wrap here on constant self-improvement and study, because this is obviously an interesting one. Obviously in the West, people always looking to do courses to better their skills, etc. But the Chinese, again, because of the competition thing, they want to stay ahead and they do insane amount of hours. Do you want to go into that?
Yeah, sure. So the difference here, as we said before, is the typical working week of a Chinese account manager that is much different from the Western account manager. As we said before, the Chinese account managers, they want to learn as quick as they can. So they have to use every day of the week that they have available for learning and working. So what happens is that in the West, we normally take our weekend off. I'm talking just about the average account manager. On a Friday, I remember when I was working in Italy and in Spain. In Italy, we were getting out of the office at 6 p.m. sharp on Friday. Very few people were staying overtime. And in Spain, on Friday, we were allowed to get out of the office at 2 p.m. So what happens, Chinese people, they don't have this large weekend. And sometimes they can also be requested to work on Saturday or Sunday because it's completely legal to do that in China. The working hour in China is 44 hours minimum, or maximum, as you could say. In Europe, in some states, it's 40, some states, it's 36. I think that Scandinavia, they have a very low number of hours. So what happens here is that they are constantly studying and improving themselves just because they want to be the first, just because they want to make more business, they want to make more money, they want to have the possibility of using the money from some big investment. And they also take this chance to attend a lot of trainings, meetups, workshops. So for example, one of the services that I provide with my company is trainings. A lot of Westerns do that in China. A lot of also Chinese people do it. The only day that you can actually really perform a training is Saturday or a Sunday, because people in China, here the sellers, they don't want to lose a day from Monday to Friday, and they would only have one day free on Saturday or Sunday to actually attend the training and the workshop. And they really want to learn as much as they can because they prefer to do that by themselves. It's not just a matter of saving money, but because they really want to do it by themselves. They really want to know how it works. Because at some point they know that they will start their own business. So they have to have the entire picture. They have to know how it works. So they will spend a lot of time in trainings. They will spend their money. They would pretty much sacrifice their going outside with their friends or whatever you're supposed to do, resting during your weekend, that, for us, especially in South Europe, this is like sacred. You don't mess with my weekend. You don't send me messages. I don't even look at the emails during the weekend. I don't want to have my boss texting me on WhatsApp. Here it's completely normal to constantly work, to constantly improve yourself, to share articles, to attend meetings and trainings, to constantly talk on WeChat about what's going on Amazon, in your industry, and whatsoever. It's a very different approach to the entire self improvement, the entire life. They spend a lot more time in working and improving themselves just because they feel this big push of being the number one. That it's, you know, it is a big difference in culture, in history, in a lot of elements. So yeah, this is actually what I see from a European point of view of a person living in China.
Yeah, I mean, what I've taken, if we wrap here, what I've taken from this conversation is that on all points, the level of competition and the lengths that maybe Chinese sellers are willing to go, you know, they like to get shit done. They're very competitive in terms of pricing. They've got access to a lot of information. The self-study means is that they replace all the competitive advantages that the West once had, you know. So it seems to me, you know, there's a famous saying that hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. It's what you put in as an entrepreneur and the workload, you know, because there's this false economy, I suppose, on Amazon sellers, you know, you sold all these kind of Ponzi scheme courses like work 3 hours a week, laptop on the beach and stuff. Yeah, that day can come at some point. But I think in order to get ahead, you need to work, you know. But yeah, it's very fascinating in terms of spending a lot of time with Chinese people. I think you've got to understand how other cultures work, because it's very easy for people to say, oh yeah, the Chinese will sell cheap products, or the Chinese are coming and they're taking over the world and the skies are falling. But ultimately, you've got to learn that we live in a world where there is competition. We sell on the marketplace, and it doesn't matter if they're Chinese or whatever nationality they are still your competition. So how can people reach you?
So you can definitely reach me through my website, through my email. Yeah. I don't mind sharing my work email, davide@wearegrowthhack.com. Yeah. My website is wearegrowthhack.com. And the last thing that I want to say, like catching this topic, the whole thing that pushed me to write this article, it was a very interesting talk that I had with one of my clients in Europe. They were struggling. They didn't know why Chinese sellers are so good. So they seriously sit me down in a meeting room for 4 hours asking me questions about Chinese sellers. And that's when I came up with this blog post about the Chinese sellers.
So let's sign off here. It's been great to have you on. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. David, again, thank you for joining us. We will be back soon. Take care.